Welcome. My name is Daniel Four. I'm here with the Voices of the Earth project of the Earth Medicine Alliance. The Alliance is an interfaith, earth-honoring organization based out of the San Francisco Bay Area, and we're dedicated to helping humans to repair our relations with the natural world. For more information about our work, please see www.earthmedicine.org. We're pleased to welcome today Chandra Alexandre. Chandra is a householder and clergy initiated in 1998 into the mysteries of the dark goddess in India, first on the dakshinacara path and then 5 years later on the non-dualistic path of vamacara tantra. She's the founder and spiritual leader of the Sharanya community and Daughters of Kali, a teaching circle dedicated to engage spirituality for social justice and transformation through revolutionary shakta tantra. Chandra and her community also run an online mystery school, Kali Vidya. Chandra holds a PhD in Asian and Comparative Studies, a Doctor of Ministry degree focused on bringing spirit to the workplace, and an MBA in Sustainable Management. She offers spiritual counseling sessions, an annual pilgrimage to India, and other ceremonies and rites of passage in the San Francisco Bay Area. Welcome.
Welcome.
Chandra, can we begin with you sharing a little bit about how you came to this work? Was your family involved in earth-honoring traditions, or was this something that you became more interested in as an adult?
I think the most direct answer to your question is that it really was something that I grew into, yet it has definite roots in my family of origin. My mother is a quarter Cherokee, and so wasn't particularly spiritually active, but was very politically active, was part of the American Indian movement in this country, and really turned me on to the awareness of the intersection of ethnicity, politics, and religion, spirituality. My grandmother, her mother, who was not of Native American descent, but was from, you can say, the old country of Eastern Europe, the western part of the Ukraine, really brought with her a sensibility about connection to the unseen world and to the world around us. So very much in the vein of the wise woman healers of pre-Christian Europe, sort of those stories, she had some sort of herbal remedy for every malady as a child growing up. Was particularly interested when menstrual cramps would bother me and had a specific combination of things to make sure that I felt better. And so that kind of an awareness and sensitivity to earth and relationship to earth and being present with earth is something that I grew up with. But the way that I knew of religion based on the world around me wasn't a way that immediately said to me the way that my mother and grandmother were practicing and were living and were being was religious, right? So my own personal quest growing out of that upbringing or ancestry really took a very meandering path through soul searching and trying different faiths in the face of my friends and the face of those in my community where I lived. I grew up in New York. So there was a plethora of options. You know, I had many, many different opportunities to try out different spiritualities and different spiritual communities. But it really was within the pagan community in New York, and the neo-pagan community in New York, that I started to find a resonance for the teachings of my mother and my grandmother, where the earth-honoring component and the relationship to the unseen world and the importance placed on personal action and responsibility all started to come together into one cohesive practice for me. And so really I think that combination of both personal spiritual questing, you know, coupled with that in my background, and then finding a rich environment in New York to sort of help shepherd, you know, me into the spirituality and the spiritual path, all came together. I mean, that was the commingling that really brought something forward in me, and that was sort of my launching pad or my stepping off place into where I sit now and what I do today.
Mm-hmm. How did you come to be inspired to form the organization Sharanya? Can you share a little bit more about Sharanya's work and what the name means and what inspired you to found the organization?
Sure. You know, I think that Maybe I'll generalize a little bit to say that many folks who feel a calling do so out of usually a personal experience, either of the divine, of the numinous, of something in their lives that has triggered a movement to connect to something larger. And, you know, I was sort of smiling as you were asking the question because there was a specific moment in my travels in India. I went to India in 1998 and I was there ostensibly to do the fieldwork for my dissertation. I wound up spending most of my time not immersed in academic work but immersed in spiritual work, and that's maybe a different story for us to get to. But I was told when I was in India, after I met my first teacher, to go spread mother worship. And so the easy answer to your question is, I was given this directive. This is what you must do as a next step and a responsibility as somebody who's taken initiation and somebody who has vowed to live a life of devotion to the goddess. You must take what you've experienced here, what you've learned here, back. And so that was a direct, you know, wish of my teacher. Go spread mother worship. And so out of that, you could say on one level the organization was formed. But you know, the deeper answer that ties really to my personal story is that when I was in India, as I mentioned, I didn't follow through on the academic commitment so much, a little bit. I mostly followed through after I was sitting in a museum in Bhubaneswar in Orissa, engaged in some sort of dialogue on the transcendental plane, if you will, with a statue of a goddess, Chamunda. Now, this goddess is a sister to Kali Ma, the Hindu great goddess of time and the void, destruction, some say. And I looked upon her with a degree of fear, a degree of reverence, a degree of sadness, because the way in which she's depicted is skeletal. And my own personal story is as someone who learned a tremendous amount about my own soul and my own spirituality through the passage of anorexia in this world. So coming face to face with a goddess who looked the way that I had started to look, who represented a disconnect from the body, and there's much more to what she represents within the Hindu tradition, the idea of consuming it all in order to birth it all. And so she stays in that liminal space represented by her skeletalness. But for me, it was profound. You know, not only do we in the West not have a divine female, this was a very provocative image and something that personally so resonated deeply with me that I think really that moment is what catalyzed everything else for me to a place of, this work is important. If you can do anything, if it's only to go back and share your story of healing, because I feel that in India, all of the work that I had done through therapy, through different somatic work, through spiritual practices, all of that sort of gave birth to a new me when I was in India. And I think that was a crystallizing moment. So those two, go spread mother worship and the personal experience that I had in relationship to Chamunda.
You use the term shakan to refer to your path and lineage. Mm-hmm. Can you share more about how these teachings understand our relationship to the divine and to the earth?
So I have how long to answer that question?
As long as you need.
So maybe I'll just talk and we'll see where this goes. So shakan as a tradition was birthed out of some of what I've already said. My experience and lineage in my family, some of the container that I experienced in New York as a young 20-something woman trying to find my way, and then some of the later practices into which I was initiated, specifically in India. It's a tradition that recognizes my situatedness as a Western woman, more broadly, our situatedness here in, well, right now at this moment in San Francisco, but for practitioners and those in my community, the fact that we arise out of a country steeped in the Abrahamic faiths and steeped in a particular social cultural milieu and so on, And we can't divorce ourselves from that. If we were born here and raised here, it's important, I think, to speak from a place recognizing that as a starting point. And so within Shakan, we do so. We then also include and transcend those roots to take a stance in relationship to a goddess who is ancient and simultaneously living, living certainly within the traditions of India, and then of course more broadly living in the hearts of not only the diaspora, but those to whom she has come and called, and I count myself among those. So in a short snippet, I can say that my questing, you know, what I've shared with you so far about my upbringing and my spiritual questing prior to going to India, you know, had another crystallizing moment, and that was in 1992 when I had a dream. And in that dream, a visage much like that appeared to me of Kali Ma. And you probably can't see it, but maybe later. But she appeared to me, one image, terrifying. I woke up in a cold sweat. I woke up like I've never woken up in the middle of the night before. And it was at a time when I was dealing with the issues from being an anorexic, psychological and physical. I was dealing with the psycho-spiritual components of who I was becoming. And she asked me one question in that dream. And it wasn't as though she spoke with her mouth, it was though the full of her being spoke to me very, very deeply. And she asked me simply, "Do you want to live? Or do you want to die? Because you have a choice." And the realization in the moment was, of course, that I was killing myself. And if I wanted to do something other, then I had to make some very dramatic changes in how I was being and showing up in the world. And so from that moment, I began doing that. And so Kali has come to many people, regardless of place of origin or birth or background and ancestry. And similarly, so have other dark goddesses. And by dark goddess, I mean generally those that we humans give a particular iconography and a particular imagery so that they can represent the fullest spectrum of who we are as humans. And I say fullest spectrum because so much of what we tend to believe, particularly in the West, about the divine is circumscribed and is only one small portion of what the divine is, and certainly doesn't represent the realities of the natural world and our experience in nature, our experience in life. And so those dark goddesses, in their blackness, in their darkness, in their fierceness, represent generally everything we choose to deny, suppress, and not acknowledge in our daily existence. And so it's a way for us to actually heal. It's a way for us actually to come into a greater experience of truth, of what it means to be in the world, and alive in the world, and vibrant in the world, and loving in the world. And so it's seemingly at odds with perhaps many people's first response to an image of a fierce goddess. Oh, terrifying. Oh, keep me away from the machete. Oh, you know, that kind of thing. Blood and head severed and all of this. But, you know, again, the truth is that in order to become whole, we have to engage with and be with and learn from those parts of what it means to be alive and human. So that's, I think, maybe a short answer that, or maybe a long answer, I don't know, that the tradition Shakan acknowledges our starting place in the Western context in the world, and then transcends that beginning to embrace a tradition and spirituality that is about ultimately health and wholeness in relationship to the dark goddess.